The other day, I came across a very provocative book title, $3 Worth of God by Wilbur Rees. The author writes, I would like to buy $3 worth of God, please. Not enough to explode my soul or disturb my sleep, but just enough to equal a cup of warm milk or a snooze in the sunshine. I don't want enough of him to make me love a black man or pick beads with a migrant. I want ecstasy, not transformation. I want the warmth of the womb, not a new birth. I want a pound of the eternal in a paper sack. I would like to buy $3 worth of God, please. Do we want all of God or only $3 worth of God? Barnabas was convicted that he should not provide just a glimpse of God or offer a shallow experience with Jesus Christ. Barnabas was willing to go a second mile in order to present the most beautiful, clear and accurate picture of God and facilitate an authentic, deep and transformational relationship with Christ to those who came to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior in Antioch. You see, Antioch was a cosmopolitan city where Jews and Gentiles, Greek and barbarian, rubbed shoulders. Antioch was the third largest city in the Roman Empire. The religious pluralism on the city was well known in the ancient world. Among the many temples in Antioch, probably the most notable was a temple to Jupiter Capitolinus that was paneled in gold. In such diversity, the first Gentile Christian community was established in Antioch. Fleeing from persecution, some heroes of faith came to Antioch. And for the first time, the good news about Jesus Christ was publicly presented to the Gentiles. The Bible tells us that the Lord was with them, and a great number of people. Just a kind reminder, every time you see a word in red, it's for you to read. The Lord's hand was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. Probably few new believers in Antioch had much biblical background or worldview. While there was a Jewish community in Antioch, the early believers were Gentiles who most likely had little knowledge of the Old Testament. The church started with converts who had limited biblical knowledge and a secular worldview. If they did have a spiritual perspective prior to their conversion, it certainly was not a Christian outlook. Soon after the church at Antioch began, Barnabas arrived from Jerusalem. He surveyed the situation. Barnabas, by the Holy Spirit, understood what was happening in Antioch, and he encouraged the believers to stay true to the Lord and observed that many people were brought to the Lord. Barnabas realized two things. He needed a strategy to solidify the church, and he needed help to accomplish it. To solve the problem, he took an unusual step. He left town for a few days. What was Barnabas' plan? Take your Bible and read Acts 11, 25 and 26 with those around you. Take some time to reflect and discuss Barnabas' plan. Barnabas understood that the new believers in Antioch had to be grounded in the scriptures and develop an authentic, deep, and transformational relationship with Jesus Christ. Their responsibility was such that Barnabas could not hope to accomplish it by himself. He had to find a colleague, but it was not easy matter to find the right man for the situation. Barnabas, however, decided that he knew the man, if he only could locate him. Several years had gone by since Saul of Tarsus had been escorted to Caesarea by his new friends in Jerusalem and put on board a ship bound for his native city. Barnabas could think of no one more eminently suited for the responsibility of sharing his ministry in Antioch. He therefore went to Tarsus in person to seek him out, a journey of at least 140 kilometers. Barnabas found Saul and took him to Antioch. The strategy that Barnabas and Paul implemented in Antioch can be summarized in these simple words. For a whole year, they met with the church and taught a great many people. The most obvious part of the strategy is the teaching ministry they launched. But the second aspect is the intentionality and continuity of their work. They taught the church for a whole year, regularly, systematically, thoroughly, repetitively, then all over again and again. The continuous stream of new believers coming into the church would have required this approach to keep everyone moving toward immaturity in Christ. The desire and feelings that motivated Paul in this endeavor in Antioch can be understood in his letter to the Galatians. Oh, my dear children, I feel as if I'm going through labor pains for you again, and they will continue until Christ is fully developed in your lives. Barnabas and Paul were not alone in their endeavors. The Bible presents the names of a few more teachers in Antioch. The teaching in Antioch was not limited to a data transfer, sharing the right information. It was a transformational experience involving teaching, action, ministry, apprenticeship, mentorship, development, and deployment of disciples. The reality is that this process of leading each believer toward maturity in Christ and deploying them for ministry was a culture that was developed in the Antioch church. This process could be understood today as discipleship. For the church at Antioch, discipleship was not only an event or a program, but was the reason for existence. The church in Antioch was the first Christian church to establish and develop a discipleship culture. What was the result? Acts 11:26. It was in Antioch that the disciples were first called Christians. Let me ask you, when you think about discipleship, what comes to your mind? Have you been involved in a discipleship process? How was that for you? Share your thoughts with those around you. C.S. Lewis rightly understood that the purpose of the church was to draw people to Christ and make them like Christ. He said that the church exists for no other purpose. If the church is not doing this, then all the cathedrals, clergy, missions, sermons, even the Bible are a waste of time. There is no other way of developing genuine transformation movements than through the critical task of disciple making. Neil Cole notes, if you cannot reproduce disciples, you cannot reproduce leaders. If you cannot reproduce leaders, you cannot reproduce church. If you cannot reproduce church, you cannot reproduce movements. Today we live in a Christian church culture that has defined discipleship as optional, a choice, and not a demand. You can be a Christian, but not necessarily a follower of Christ, a disciple. I think it is safe to say that every disciple of Jesus is a Christian. But it is not always safe to assume that every person labeled Christian is a disciple. That's wrong, completely wrong. We need to follow the footsteps of the Antioch Church and create a culture of disciple making. We must follow Jesus' great commission. Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations. Baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Disciple making is the mandate, and transformation the desired outcome. The logical question is, how are we doing? What could be done? What could you do to help and promote the development of a discipleship culture in your spiritual community, in your church? Take this time now to reflect and discuss this crucial question. Thank you. I just appreciate how Jeff Iorg summarizes the discipleship culture of the Antioch Church. By any measure, the church at Antioch is a model of transformation. Through its teaching ministry, in obedience to Jesus' instructions, disciples were made in Antioch. Doctrinal convictions were established, stewardship was learned and practiced, worship was cultivated, witnessing and missionary outreach flourished, and church problems were solved by applying principles of the gospel in an interpersonal relationships. The spring from which these chains emerged was new birth in Jesus. The channel which guided the flow toward maturity was the teaching ministries of Paul, Barnabas, Agabus, Judas, Silas, Simon, Lucius, and Manaen, and possible others. Antioch is an inspiring model of a teaching church. It is a good example of a church making disciples, men and women renewing their minds and learning to act more like Jesus. Let's follow Antioch's footsteps. Let's be a transformational church, a disciple-making church. Let's be the church, loving and serving.